Why don't you stand together with me as we'll begin by singing. Welcome to McKee Road Baptist Church. We're going to begin by singing There Is a Fountain in the dark blue hymnal or on the screen, song number 41.
There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, and sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilty stains. Dear dying Lamb, thy precious blood shall never lose its power, till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more, be saved to sin no more, be saved to sin no more, till all the ransomed church of God be since my faith I saw the stream thy glowing wounds supply, redeeming love has been my theme and shall be till I die, and shall
now let's go ahead and turn to song number 43. I'm going to let you sit down for just a sec. 43. Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood. Oh. Jesus.
Sinners saved by grace. Sinners saved by grace. There's a couple of us like this song. Amen. Amen.
If you could see what I once was, if you could go with me
together as we sing our last hymn this morning. Song number 42, Saved by the Blood. Sing it out.
Saved by the blood of the crucified one, now ransomed from sin and a new work begun. Sing praise to the Father and praise to the Son. Saved by the blood of the crucified one.
Now you're going to have to help me out when we get to that chorus and get those high notes. That's at the top of the range. If I went any higher, it's because somebody would be hurting me, poking me, or stepping on my foot or something. So ladies, help me out, okay? Here we go.
Saved by the blood of the crucified one, the angels rejoicing because it is done. A child of the Father, joint heir with the Son, saved by the blood of the crucified one.
Here we go.
Saved, saved, my sins are all pardoned, my guilt is all gone.
Seated. Amen. It's good to see all the folks in here. We've got some back that have been sick. And we've got Brother Rick back. Brother Rick back from being out there at the Super Bowl and witnessing a bit of testimony. Brother Rick, do you have just a couple of words of encouragement, how it went? Number was saved at your...
The crowd was probably the most receptive I've ever seen in a Super Bowl.
Amen. Wow. 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 Praise the Lord.
So I know at least six professions of faith that were made over the weekend.
Amen.
One on our team on Sunday.
Amen.
A man that sat for over an hour going through the Bible, going through the gospel. That was really encouraging.
It is.
But it was a really good outreach. As I said, a lot of people were open to hearing the gospel. They were more than have ever seen the Super Bowl. I mean, just
praise God.
Uh-huh. And then we preached, normally we just preach Friday, Saturday, Sunday, but we started preaching Saturday before. We preached for 9 days, basically.
Amen.
And we just, even on the Saturday, Sunday, and Monday, it was super cold and windy, the first weekend I was there. So we had, like, far fewer people out, but we seemed to have more one-on-one personal conversations with people.
Good.
It seemed like people who were out were open for me to hear the gospel.
Good. Miraculous. Amen. I appreciate your willingness to be a part of that. These evangelists that went out, that's what they are, evangelists taking the gospel and sharing it with those that maybe have never heard, some have heard, and maybe the seed's been planted, and just an opportunity for... Oh, amen.
I'm going to go attend it. And a friend of mine, Tony Miata, is a street preacher. He's going to be coming into town to teach.
Okay.
And we're going to be out there with you and doing some street evangelism with Brother Graves.
All right.
If it's interesting, let me know. If you go down there, be part of that conference.
Amen. Brother Max Graves, good preacher, good man, good man of God. Thank you, Rick. Appreciate that word of testimony. Take your Bibles and open to the book of Acts, if you will. Book of Acts. We are doing a searching of the book of Acts, walking with the Savior. This is our third lesson, and guess what? We made it to verse 3 now. We made it to verse 3. We're not trying to run through the book and say that we've taught the book or we've read through the book or we've studied the book. We really want to take some time in the book of Acts. The book of Acts is a book of history. The book of Acts is about the New Testament church, and we're laying the foundation for this as we go into it. I'll do a little bit of a review this morning and then get into our lesson for today. And it is much like a lesson, much like a lesson, because we are trying to learn what a true New Testament church really is. What does it take to make a New Testament church? People all over Bakersfield, all over California, all over the United States are going to what they call a church. Is it a true church? We need to be able to identify. This is our heritage. This is our heritage. Remember the first lesson I talked about how that some of us go into on the internet and we do searches and we try to find out about our ancestries and those that lived before us and the silly things they did and some of the things not so silly, some of the things are good things. You know, I had a relative that got into the shootout with Jesse James. You know, anybody have anybody like that in their family? Okay, well, part of my crazy family. But we're searching this because we want to know what is the heritage, our heritage. Our first Sunday, we talked about walking with the Savior and talked about how that he had a new way, a new kind of doing things. He came and he did miracles. Remember, the first miracle was turning the water into wine. And the last miracle before the crucifixions, where Peter cut the ear off of that soldier and Jesus healed his ear. He had a new kind of living. New kind of living. He lived without sin. There was something different about this man, this Jesus. And there was a new kind of teaching. He taught, they said, with authority. He taught with authority. Christine's going to be teaching here, and she wants to teach with authority in her classes, be in charge. We talked last week about the source of the message, the source of the message. God's word instructs us to study to show ourselves approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth, 2 Timothy 2:15. that we talked about the substance of the message in Luke 24:47, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. Now, this is key. Repentance is an action of man toward God. And remember, remission is an action of God toward men, where it's paid, it's taken care of. We talked about the significance of the message, how that repentance and remission should be preached among all nations. We talked about the scope of the message and how that it's, we are witnesses of these things, and we need to be teaching this beginning at Jerusalem. Then we talked about the success of the message in Luke 24:49. It says, "And behold, I send you the promises my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high." And wow, what power. A lot of people make much of this filling of the Holy Spirit, how that in Acts 1:8, and they take it in a direction that was not intended to be. The power was given because we are to be witnesses. It was given us power to be witnesses. Today, we're going to continue with our walk through the book of Acts. We're purposely moving slowly through the book of Acts. Why do you say you're moving slowly? Well, I can't go real fast, so I'm going to go nice and slow. We need to desire, and we should desire to know what a true New Testament church. And every step we take in the book of Acts will help you not only to know the history of the church, but it'll increase your faith as you increase in knowledge. Today we'll consider the proofs of the resurrection. The proofs of the resurrection. Acts chapter 1 and verse 3. Well, let's go ahead and read the first three verses. It says, The former treatise have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach, until the day in which he was taken up, after that he, through the Holy Ghost, had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. Let's go to God in prayer. As I pray, you pray. Folks, listen, if you want to meet with God today, it's not going to happen just because you came in and sit down. You need to be ready. Prepare your heart. As I pray, you pray that God, please meet with us. Let's pray. Father, just a few minutes we're going to spend in your word this morning. And Lord, we want you to teach us. Father, I ask that as we come and gathered here together today, McKee Road Baptist Church members, visitors, that we've done so in a way that our hearts are ready to receive from you the message that you have for us. Teach us, O God, we pray in your name. Amen. You know, I was talking to Brother Tim this morning. He said, I got a jury summons, you know, a notice to go be a juror. And I had one just I had to call in last Monday night. They said, you might be a potential juror. Of course, my thought is, why? We get them in, you turn them out. We get them in, you turn them out. Up in Stockton, where my family lives, my brother says, like a turnstile. They just go in one door and come out the next, you know, and never do anything. But anyway, I digress. But if you to go to a court of law and you're going to have a trial and somebody's been accused of something, what is it? The prosecution will gather all of his evidence, right? They gather all the evidence together. And then what do? They take it and they present it. They present it. There's nothing as solid as an eyewitness account. An eyewitness account. Somebody says, well, I didn't do that. Well, you have three people over here. I saw you do it. An eyewitness account is a great proof. That's what Jesus did. That's what Jesus provided. Before the apostles could undertake it was a humanly impossible task of convincing a Christ-rejecting world of the truth of the gospel, they needed a 40-day post-resurrection time contact with the Lord. Jesus was going to return to heaven soon, but before he did, he gave them, look at the verse 3. It says, by many infallible proofs. Jesus provided many infallible proofs that he was resurrected. Jesus had been crucified. He died and he was buried. You know, it's interesting as we look through the Gospels, how quickly the disciples forgot what Jesus had told them about the resurrections. You know who remembered it, though? The enemies. The enemies remembered it. Remember what happened? They warned Pilate about it. What did they do? They said, we're going to seal this tomb with this big stone. And they even placed guards there. They were afraid that some may have believed in the resurrection, but some said, you know, we're going to put that stone there because we don't want those disciples to come and steal that body away. But he died, was buried. The enemies of Jesus thought they would never hear from him again. But after the resurrection, let's go to our proofs. Luke chapter 23, verse 56. Get your Bibles ready. Have them handy. If you're good on that phone, you know, get that phone. How many are using a phone this morning? Just raise your hand high. I can see. I'm just curious. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. How many are old school like me? Right here. Okay. All right. Now, I've typed out these verses. And so if I read it incorrectly, please forgive me. Okay. But it helps me. Luke chapter 23, verse 56. Now, I'm going to go ahead and turn there myself. Luke 23, right at the end of the chapter. It says, and they returned and prepared spices and ointments and rested the Sabbath day according to the commandment, as with the practice to complete the entombment of Jesus, to prepare the body. They were bringing spices and balm. And then in chapter 24, verse 1, it says, now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came into the sepulcher, bringing the spices which they had prepared and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulcher. They must have been in shock to have walked up there. The stone's been moved. And they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood about them in shining garments. Now, try to put yourself in their place. Interject yourself into the story this morning as if you're standing there with them and you see what's going on. You know your Lord and Savior has been crucified. He's died. And he's gone and been put in that tomb. Now, they come to the tomb and the stone's been rolled away. And they go in, and the body's not there. Verse 5, and as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said unto them, why seek ye the living among the dead? Wow, that's a great title for a message. He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee? Saying, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again. And they remembered his words. Verse 9, and they returned from the sepulchre and told all these things unto the eleven and to all the rest. Who was it? Look who it was. It was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary the mother of James and other women that were with them, which told these things unto the apostles. Now, look at verse 11. And their words seemed to be them as idle tales, and they believed them not. They told the apostles this, and they didn't believe them. They didn't believe them. You know, you look at some of these women that went there. Mary Magdalene had seven devils cast out of her. Joanna had been, God had done a work in her life. You know, it's no wonder to me that these women were there. Because when God does a wonderful work in your life and you realize it, you want to be around him. We're talking about proofs. Jesus is showing himself. How brave these women were as they came to the tomb on that resurrection day. There's a lot of unrest going on. We think that we have a lot of unrest here in America today. There was a lot of unrest there. As they walked, they postulated who might move the stone for them. And they said among themselves, who shall roll away the stone from the door of the sepulcher? Mark chapter 16, verse 3. How are we going to get in there? How are we going to take care of our Savior? Yes, they were brave, but they were also unbelieving. And when they found that the stone had been rolled away, turn with me to Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. Much like a Bible drill, but we are doing a lesson here this morning. We're trying to set the foundation as we study of the book of Acts. Matthew chapter 28. Matthew 28, beginning at verse 2, it says, and behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake. Who are the keepers? The guards. The guards. Oh, my goodness. These were not just, trying to be politically correct here. These were not weak men, okay? These were soldiers. They're guarding this. I would have to think that they sent some of their best soldiers, right? The keepers. And yet the angel, you have this earthquake, and the angel descended from heaven, and he rolled the stone away, and he sat on it. You know, to me, that's like saying, I got this. You know, you thought you had it shut, but I got this. And it says, and the angel answered and said to the women, fear not ye, for I know ye seek Jesus which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said, come see the place where the Lord lay. Praise God. He is risen. Folks, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. He is risen indeed. As the women left the tomb, they met the Lord. Go on down with me in this same chapter, verse 9. And behold, they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, all hail. And they came and held him by the feet and worshiped him. They just fell down and grabbed his feet and worshiped him. Then said Jesus unto them, be not afraid. Go tell my brethren that they go into Galilee, and there shall they see me. Then in obedience to the command, take your Bibles, open to Mark, book of Mark, chapter 16. Now the first three Gospels are called what? The what type of Gospels? Synoptic Gospels. Synoptic Gospels. Very good. Synoptic Gospels. And they went and told the disciples and Peter in verse 9, 16 verse 9. Now when Jesus was risen early the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast seven devils. Seven devils. You know what? That same Jesus lives today and has the power to do miraculous things. There are those that would say he does no miracles. There are those that come around and say, I do miracles on behalf of Jesus. Let me tell you something, folks. Jesus does miracles. The miracle of being born again is the greatest of all. And verse 10, and she went and told them that had been with him as they mourned and wept. They're crying. Their Lord and Savior had been with three and a half years. He's been killed. He's been killed. You watch someone pass away, they're gone. They're not coming back. But there's something about this Jesus that was different. And they, when they had heard that he was alive and had been seen of her, believed not. My goodness. They couldn't believe it. They couldn't grasp it. They believed not. Well, that's one proof. The women saw, an eyewitness, many infallible proofs. Another proof. How about the guards? How about the guards? Back to Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. I'm talking about the proofs of the resurrection. While this was going on, the guards had fled to Jerusalem to report what had happened at the tomb. Matthew 28 and verse 11, it says, "Now, when they were going, behold, some of the watch came into the city and showed unto the chief priests all the things that were done. And when they were assembled with the elders and had taken counsel, they gave large money to the soldier." What are they doing? They're buying them off. Verse 13, saying, "Say ye," this is what we're going to do, "his disciples came by night and stole him away while we slept." Now, if you're one of these guards, you got to be thinking, "Oh, wait a minute, if I say that I was asleep on watch, that's going to be a problem." And in verse 14, "And if this come to the governor's ear, we will persuade him and secure you. Don't worry about it. We're going to take care of you. This is the plan. This is the story we're going to tell." So they took the money and did as they were taught. And this saying is commonly reported among the Jews until this day. The Jews are still waiting for the Messiah. Still waiting for the Messiah. There's proof in that the guards saw what happened. How about Peter and John? Peter and John, take your Bibles, open to Luke chapter 20. Luke chapter 20. Luke chapter 20. I think I've written down the wrong verse. Well, the verse I have... Okay, I've given you the wrong scripture, so I'll just read the scripture. It says, "Then arose Peter and ran unto the sepulchre, and stooping down, he beheld the linen clothes laid by themselves, and departed, wondering in himself at which was come to pass." Which was come to pass. They didn't find the body of Jesus. Go back to another proof, Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene. In John chapter 20. John chapter 20. John chapter 20. Well, somebody might say, "Well, yeah, but your proof text is the Word of God." And that's kind of like circular reasoning. You know, you can't say something's true from that and then prove it because you say it came from that. I remember I took a class. It was in college. And the instructor, it was interesting enough, it was a religious portion of this class. And so I was using the Bible, and I said, "Here's my proof." And she said, "That's circular reasoning." And I said, "But the Word of God is truth. The Word of God is truth." In John chapter 20, beginning in verse 11. "But Mary stood without at the sepulchre weeping. As she wept, she stooped down and looked into the sepulchre, and seeth two angels in white sitting, the one at the head and the other at the feet where the body of Jesus had lain. And they said unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? She saith unto them, Because they have taken away my Lord, and I know not where they have laid him. And when she had thus said, she turned herself back and saw Jesus standing, and knew not it was Jesus. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou? She, supposing him to be the gardener, saith unto him, Sir, if thou have borne him hence, tell me where thou hast laid him, and I will take him away. Jesus saith unto her, Mary." Oh, Mary. Her heart must have leapt. "She turned herself and saith unto him, Rabboni, which is to say, Master. Jesus saith unto her, Touch me not, for I am not yet ascended to go to my Father, but go to my brethren, and say unto them, I ascend to my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord, and that he had spoken these things unto her." How about proof of two disciples? Back to Luke. Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24 begin in verse 13. Luke chapter 24, verse 13. And behold, two of them went that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem about 80 furlongs. And they talked together of all these things which had happened. Wouldn't you be talking about this? What's going on? I'm hearing rumors that the tomb is empty. I don't know. What do you think's going on? Do you think somebody stole the body? I don't know. Did he raise from the dead? I don't know. And they're talking together. And it came to pass, verse 15, that while they communed together and reasoned, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. That's another good title. But their eyes were holden that they should not know him. And when he said unto them, what manner of communications are these that ye have one to another as ye walk and are sad? And the one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answering, said unto him, art thou only a stranger in Jerusalem and hast not known the things which are come to pass there in these days? You know, they didn't have the internet. They didn't have media like we have today. You couldn't get on your phone and go, oh, look what's happening. This has happened. They didn't have any of that. And yet this was spread abroad. This is just like wildfire. I can only imagine. And then it's verse 19, it says, and he said unto them, what things? What things? The Lord knew. And they said unto him, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, which was a prophet, mighty indeed in word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and have crucified him. But we trusted that it had been he which should have redeemed Israel. And beside all this, today is the third day since these things were done. Significant about that third day. Yea, and certain women also of our company made us astonished, which were early at the sepulchre, and they found not his body. They came, saying that they had also seen a vision of angels, which said that he was alive. And certain of them which were with us went to the sepulchre and found it, even so as the women had said, but him they saw not. They've got to be just in their heart, there's got to be hope that he had really resurrected, and then hope that someone had not stolen his body. Then he said unto them, O fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken, ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things saying, the things concerning himself. And they drew nigh unto the village whither they went, and he made as though he would have gone further. Boy, that's something. At some point, the Lord appeared unto Peter privately. You look in Luke 24, 33, 34, it says, and they rose up the same hour and returned to Jerusalem and found the 11 gathered together and them that were with them, saying, the Lord is risen indeed and hath appeared to Simon. Talking about proofs, infallible proofs, the many infallible proofs, proofs of the 11 disciples. Proof of the 11 disciples. Back to John. Verse 19, then the same day at evening, when the first day of the week, the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for the fear of the Jews. You know what? They killed our Lord and Savior. What's to say they're not going to come for us next? What's to say they're not going to come for us next? They're afraid of the Jews. Came Jesus. Jesus came and stood in the midst and said unto them, peace be unto you. How would you like to be assembled at that time into a room? And then all of a sudden Jesus is there. Wow. You know, we have the Holy Spirit here today with us. Promises his presence with us today. Where two or three are gathered together, there am I in their midst. Jesus is meeting with us today. Verse 20, and when he had so said, and he showed him unto him his hands and his side, then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. Then said Jesus to them again, peace be unto you. As my Father hath sent me, even so send I you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said unto them, receive ye the Holy Ghost. Whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted unto them. And whosoever sins ye retain, they are retained. The Lord challenged them again with the Great Commission. Proof of the 11 disciples. John chapter 21. John chapter 21. Verse 1, after these things, Jesus showed himself to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias. And on this wise showed he himself. There were together Simon, Peter, and Thomas, called Didymus, and Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples. Simon Peter saith unto them, I go a-fishing. You know, Peter just gets fed up. Maybe this is not working out like we thought. I'm just going to go fishing. I'm going to do what I know. I go fishing. They said unto them, we also will go with thee. They went forth and entered into a ship immediately that night. They caught nothing. But when the morning was now come, Jesus stood on the shore. But the disciples knew not that it was Jesus. Then said Jesus unto them, children, have ye any meat? They answered him, no. And he said unto them, cast the net on the right side of the ship, and ye shall find. They cast therefore, and now were not able to draw it for the multitude of fishes. Therefore, that disciple whom Jesus loved saith unto Peter, it is the Lord. Now when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he girded his fisher's coat unto him, for he was naked, and did cast himself into the sea. And the other disciples came in a little ship, for they were not far from land, but as it were 200 cubits, dragging the nets with fishes. And soon then as they were come to land, they saw a fire of coals there and fish laid on there on and bread. Proof of the 11 disciples, seven disciples. Proof of the seven disciples. You know, when God created Adam, he said, and God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth on the earth. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. This is very key, very important. You see, when God created Adam, and he put him in the garden, he gave him control. He was like king. He's over this. He's over all this. But you know, as Adam reigned, Adam sinned. And when he sinned, he surrendered his authority to reign to Satan, this kingdom of God. Immediately when sin reigned and death reigned, so now, guess what? Satan reigns. Satan was reigning. When Adam's children were born, they were born into the wrong kingdom, became subject to the wrong sovereign. They were born into sin. And they were subject to Satan. It was necessary for God to assert his sovereignty. That's why he set out the plan. He's going to pronounce judgment on the serpent and on the sinners. He declared a war between the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent. And God provided a means to put away the sinner's guilt so that fallen men might once again obtain the citizenship, the kingdom of God. This kingdom of God. John chapter 3, verse 3. Turn there. John 3, verse 3. Jesus talked about this kingdom of God. John chapter 3, verse 3. It's what he's trying to do. Bring him back into the kingdom of God. So he's talking to Nicodemus. Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot what? See the kingdom of God. He cannot see the kingdom of God. During this 40 days following his resurrection, the Lord spoke to his disciples, things pertaining to the kingdom of God. A few years before the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 6, 23, he said this, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." No doubt, Jesus rehearsed this with them. Rehearsed this with them. Leave. Don't get caught up in all worldly goods. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. Talking this morning about the proofs, the many infallible proofs that Jesus left us about his resurrection. Every head bowed and every eye closed. I'm going to have a word of prayer. Father, I ask that at this time, as we take just a moment to consider the truth of your word spoken this morning, the many infallible proofs you have provided us of your resurrection. God, that you would speak to our hearts and cause us to ask, so what am I doing with this proof? What am I doing with this proof? God, as we take just a moment, may you have your will. May you have your way. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Every head bowed.